Thank you. you. Father God, that your goodness, your mercy, your love chases us. And that's our foundation. Our foundation is your goodness. Our foundation is your love. Our foundation is all of the things that you have given us. And God, I pray for those whose faith is weak today. Those who are weak, those who feel like they're carrying really heavy weights, and they hear that song and they're like, I don't know. I don't know if you're good. I don't know if you've got me. Everything is shaking. My world's falling apart. I'm sick. I'm tired. I'm depressed. I'm angry. Lord, I just pray for those people right now, Lord God. Lord God, that their faith would be built on you, not their circumstances. This world's going to rock us. This world's going to shake us, but you remain the same. Your promises are your word. You have remained faithful through the generations. Lord God, you are good. You are good when it hurts, and you are good when it's great, and you are good when it's shaking. Lord God, I just pray for those today, God, that they would just stand in faith today. They would worship in faith today. Lord, you are good. We thank you.
Held in your hands from the moment that I raised. Good morning, Wendy Water.
Good morning.
That was loud. Is that better? So my name's Joe. I'm an associate pastor here at Living Water, and I am going to move into communion now. I get to give the message in 2 weeks. 2 weeks I'll be up here giving the message, and the message is going to be about repentance. And a lot of people don't understand that repentance is love, right? Repentance is our love for God, because God has given us so much love. So when we repent, we're leaning in and loving on God, and in turn, He's loving on us. I mean, it's just an amazing thing. I'm going through something intensely personal right now, and I got to sit with a good friend, a brother, really, this morning, and talk about that and be vulnerable and open up. And I felt His love, right? I felt my friend's love as he was sitting there talking to me and listening to me and just being there for me. But I also felt God's love. And I think the only other time that I feel God's love is when I go in like that, right? That intense is when I go into communion, when I do communion, when I'm separating myself out from everything and everyone and just going to His table and sitting with Him and breaking bread. And I think it's just so cool. It's just so cool. I just love Jesus so much, and I know and I feel that He loves me too. I'm going to read out of 1 Corinthians 11, 23 through 27. For I received from the Lord what I also passed on to you. The Lord Jesus, on the night He was betrayed, took bread. And when He had given thanks, He broke it and said, "This is my body, which is for you. Do this in remembrance." In the same way, after supper, He took the cup, saying, "This cup is the new covenant in my blood. Do this whenever you drink it in remembrance of me. For whenever you eat this bread and drink this cup, you proclaim the Lord's death until He comes. So then whoever eats the bread or drinks the cup of the Lord in an unworthy manner will be guilty of sinning against the body and the blood of the Lord." Let's pray. Dear Heavenly Father, thank You. Thank You for everything that You've done in our lives. Thank You for salvation. Thank You for all the blessings. Thank You for all of our children and the laughter and the struggle. Thank You for the struggle, because without the struggle, we wouldn't know what the real love is, right? As we take communion today, Lord, I just ask that that we all be present, we all be there, so that we can feel Your love, so that we can feel who You are, feel that fatherly love coming down on us. We're so looking forward to seeing You again. In Jesus' name I pray. Amen. You may take the elements.
Oh,
Church here is alive and standing before you with her arms raised up because we are alive and well. And we believe in you. We believe what Jesus did for us. That you went to that cross for us. That you rose again and that there is victory over death. There's victory over illness. There's victory over addictions. There's victory over our circumstances. So we stand before you alive and well because we're a church that believes in you, that we are alive, we are free, we are forgiven. And there's power in the name of Jesus. We give it all to you. We surrender it all to you. In Jesus' name, amen. Yeah, you can have a seat there. Yeah, I'm Pastor Mark. I'm the prayer pastor here at Living Water. If you notice on your seats there's these prayer cards. Really encourage you to fill those out. On the back, there's a place for the prayer requests and praises. We have an amazing prayer team here at Living Water and prays for those throughout the week. So you can fill those out and place them in the black box there on the table or in the buckets that will be coming around soon. So good to stand before him and worship today, isn't it? Amen.
So good to be a part of a praying church. I'm going to ask my ushers to come forward as we move into the next phase of worship, which is tithe and offering.
Amen. Let us give.
Let us give.
Amen.
That's right, Bill. Here at Living Water, there's so many different ways to give. Sorry, my brain just shut down on me. You got the app. You can text it. You can go to the website. You can put it in the buckets as the ushers come around, or you can put it in that little black box over by the door. I'm going to pray and then we'll have the ushers come around. Your Heavenly Father, thank you. Thank you for giving us so many different ways to worship you, to serve you, not only by giving our treasure, but also using that treasure to serve others. It's just so grateful, so filled with love today. In Jesus' name I pray. Amen.
Happy Baptism Sunday! Jesus looks good on you! It's a party in heaven! Living Water, do you feel like you're never a part of anything? And when you are, you may be being picked last? Well, Jesus isn't picking you just because you're last to be picked. He's choosing you first. He's leaving 99 to get to you. So, he doesn't care about your mess, past or present. Jesus loves using messy people. Look at me and Ox. So, come grab an apron, come grab a sign, come grab a smile, and if you want to be a part of a Jesus-led team, we would love for you to volunteer in our welcome center, our youth ministry, our children's ministry, or our cafe. If you are interested, We'll see you at the Welcome Center after service today.
Be the church, church. Woo! Water, make sure you grab your phones, your tablets, whatever you use to stay connected, because we want you to download our Living Water app so that you can stay in touch with all things Living Water. You can get notifications and updates about what's going on here at Living Water, so be sure and download that app.
Youth, 7th through 12th grade, we are meeting first and third Sunday of the month. This month, in October, you'll find Billy at the youth ministry.
Woo! Yeah, you! Hey ladies, we're talking to you because you're not going to want to miss our Women's Work Day on October 5th at 9 a.m. at Miss Judy's house. We're going to be getting all the things ready for our upcoming Women's Conference. So we'll be doing the center pieces and wrapping some chapsticks, getting ready for our little craft that we have going on. So you're not going to want to miss it. October 5th, 9 a.m. at Miss Judy's house. And
talking... Bring a glue gun!
Oh yes, please bring a glue gun.
We got the joy, 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 joy down in our hearts. Where? Down in our hearts.
What?
What?
Down in our hearts. Okay.
Yeah.
Woo! Okay, ladies, joy in our hearts on October 19th. We cannot wait to fellowship with you and just have an amazing time, joy in Jesus. We have some guest speakers. We'll have worship, a craft. Lunch will be served, so don't forget to get signed up. For that, you have a chance to win a $150 value gift basket if you sign up by Tuesday. So, joy in Jesus coming your way October 19th. Get signed up.
Woo! Is your soul thirsty, Living Water? The water's fine. Have a great week. Woo! Oh!
Good morning, Living Water.
Good morning.
It's good to be in God's house today. Amen.
Yeah.
It's so good to be here. Well, listen, I want to just jump into God's Word today as we continue on in worship, as we are focused on the vision of Living Water, and this is the last week that we will be focusing on it, but it's also Baptism Sunday, and so I was just told today, this morning, that there are some folks here who have a heater for the water that we can heat it up as hot as we want. So I thought, how cool would it be if we baptized in a blizzard? Just out there, right? Those who are getting in, it'd be cold when you get out, but I don't know, I'm thinking about it, right?
Cool is the right word.
What's that?
Cool is the right word.
Cool, that's exactly right, yeah. So let's jump into God's Word right now. So open up your Bibles to John chapter 4. That's where we're going to camp out today, the first 14 verses of John 4. And so as you're doing that, turn to your neighbor and say, Jesus looks good on you.
Jesus looks good on you.
Jesus looks good on you. You guys said it so enthusiastically. So turn to your neighbor and say, now listen, Jesus looks good on you, and I mean it this time. Okay? That make you feel better, right? Oh my gosh, they really mean it this time, right? So John chapter 4, if you got it, say amen.
Amen.
If you need a minute, say give me a minute. All right, let's stand as we read God's word. That's what we do here at Living Water, is to honor him and honor his word as we dive into it. So John chapter 4 says this: when Jesus learned that the Pharisees had heard he was making and baptizing more disciples than John, though Jesus himself was not baptizing, but his disciples were, he left Judea and went again to Galilee. He had to travel, say he had to. He had to travel through Samaria. So he came to a town of Samaria called Sychar, near the property that Jacob had given his son Joseph. Jacob's well was there, and Jesus, worn out from his journey, sat down at the well. It was about noon. A woman of Samaria came to draw water. Give me a drink, Jesus said to her, because his disciples had gone into town to buy food. How is it that you, a Jew, ask for a drink from me, a Samaritan woman? She asked him, for Jews do not associate with Samaritans. And Jesus answered, if you knew the gift of God and who was saying to you, give me a drink, you would ask him and he would give you living water. Sir, said the woman, you don't even have a bucket, and the well is deep.
So where are you going to get this living water? You aren't greater than our father Jacob, are you? He gave us this well and drank from it himself, and so did his sons and livestock. And Jesus said, everyone who drinks from this water will get thirsty again. But whoever drinks from the water that I will give him will never get thirsty again. In fact, the water I will give him will become a well of water springing up in him for eternal life. Amen. Heavenly Father, we love you. You are so good to us, and we thank you, Father, for what you're doing and what you're about to do. Father, we ask, God, that you just open up our hearts and guide us and move in us and through us. And Father, we ask, God, that you would speak deep into us. Lord, I pray, God, that you would open our eyes so that we can see your word more clearly. Father, I pray that you'd open up our ears so we can hear your word more clearly. And Lord, I pray you'd open up our hearts so we can feel your word more clearly. God, we sure do love you. And we thank you for what you're about to do. It's in Jesus' name we pray. Amen.
Amen.
As you have a seat, turn to three people and say, Jesus is our foundation.
Jesus is our foundation.
So during this process, as God was giving me this vision for living water in 2016, as he said, here's what I want you to do, here's what it looks like. And 2 weeks ago, we talked about what it means to be serving inside the house. Last week, we talked about how we are to impact the community in Jesus' name. And as God gave me this this vision, and as I was on my run, he says, Jason, not only am I going to give you this vision, but I'm also going to give you the name of the church. And he says, the name of this church will be called Living Water because Cheyenne, Wyoming needs my living water. And he showed me this chapter. He showed me this book in John chapter 4. So what I want to do is I want to walk you through what we just discovered here, what we just read here. And you need to understand that in this scripture, verses 1 through 14, Jesus, it said that he had to go to Samaria. He had to go through Samaria. And in order for you to understand what that verse is talking about, it is saying that the Jews, they disliked the Samaritans. They had almost like a hatred for these folks. And they considered the Samaritans to be unclean. They're an unclean race. And so the Samaritans of Jesus' time, they were the descendants of the Jews and the people of mixed ancestry and syncretic religious practices. And the Jews despised them. And they would not be caught dead being around any Samaritan or even go through Samaria. They would rather walk around this town than to walk through this town. But Jesus, who breaks all the rules, he had to go into Samaria. He walked into Samaria. Now the Bible tells us that he was tired and that he had to sit down. So he sat down at Jacob's well and he was thirsty. And the Bible tells us it's about noon. It's lunchtime. Everybody is on their breaks. It's important for us to know that he's at Jacob's well, he's in Samaria, and it's noontime. And so he's sitting here and he's just waiting to get a drink. Now his disciples are gone and they went to go get him some food. They ran down to get some McDonald's or Firehouse Subs or whatever, right? We're gonna come back with some food. And so he's just waiting there. It's about noon. There's this woman who shows up at noon and this is not normal. This doesn't happen. You see, what happens is that the women would come up to this well, and they would come in the morning and in the evening times. And this is where they would come and draw the water out of the well. This is where the ladies would come and get the town gossip. You know, oh, did you see what she was wearing? And oh, did you see what was going on? Did you see that there's a sale going on over there at the camel store? I mean, there's all kinds of stuff that was just happening there, right? They're talking to each other. They're high-fiving each other. Then they're just going about their day. But she shows up at noon. She's by herself. She comes alone. And here's the thing. The town people know everything about her. They know everything about her because she's not living life like the other women. So she's an outcast. She's someone that's looked down upon. She's lonely. She doesn't have many friends, maybe no friends. And so here she comes to the well. Jesus is sitting there, and she's drawing water from the well. It's awkward because it's quiet. Jesus, a Jewish man, sitting at the well, and she's just drawing water. Do you think she even made eye contact with him? This is strange. She doesn't know he's Jesus. This is strange. So Jesus breaks protocol, and he speaks to her. Okay, now remember, he's in a city that Jewish people avoid. He's a single Jewish man, and you just don't talk to strange women. Let that sink in, fellas. So she knows the rules, and she calls him out because he says, "Hey man, will you give me a drink?" And she calls him out, right? She says, "Wait a minute." So his statement, "Give me a drink," led to her response is, "How is it that you, a Jew, ask for a drink from a Samaritan woman?" And his response is out of this world. His response says, "If you knew the gift of God who was saying this to you," meaning if you knew that I, Jesus, the coming Messiah, was speaking to you, "then you would ask me to give you living water," which is eternal life. And she did not pick up at all what Jesus was talking about. And so she starts asking all kinds of questions. He breaks protocol. She's there at noon. Nobody's there to witness this. You should not be talking to each other. And he asked her for a drink. He tells her, "If you ask me, I'll give you living water." She starts breaking protocol and starts having a conversation with him. And she starts asking questions. He says, "Give me a drink." She's like, "Where's your bucket?" The well is deep. It's impossible for you to even get a drink. In fact, this woman here is asking all the wrong questions. She was stuck thinking about physical water, wondering where and how Jesus was going to get this water. Did this strange Jew think he was better than Jacob and his patriarchs? You see, here's the thing. She was leaning in on her own understanding. Sometimes I wonder if maybe we have that same kind of conversation with Jesus ourselves. Sometimes I wonder when Jesus comes and sits at our well, and he starts talking and breaking protocol because you don't want him to talk to you, because if he talks to you, he's going to make you do things that you probably don't want to do, or you're going to have to correct, or someone you're going to have to forgive, or something you're going to have to mend, or something you're going to have to stop doing, and he starts talking to you, and we start asking all the wrong questions. Well, what about Stevie? What about Joni? What about Chachi? What about all those guys? Right? Why are you always coming to pick on me? Anybody here? Anybody here have those kind of conversations, right? Nobody's raising their hands, but everybody's doing this. Yeah? Yeah, Jason, that's me. Can I just tell you something? I love when God wants to be relational. Amen. I love that God wants to show up and sit at my well. Yes. I love the fact that God shows up and he's waiting for me to get where I'm about to go. And it's the place that some of us are uncomfortable. It's sometimes we lean in on what we want and we don't pay attention and listen to what he's saying. Ooh, that's so deep. Yeah. You should probably write that down. So Jesus answered her, right? "You don't have a bucket, the well is deep. Jacob and his sons drank from here, even his livestock drank from here. What are you gonna do?" Right? And Jesus says this is so profound. Jesus says, "Listen, you keep coming back to this well to draw water to quench your physical thirst. And you just keep coming back because you get thirsty again and again." He says, "But what I offer living water that quenches your spiritual thirst completely. It will become a well." It's not going to become like a well. It is a well of water springing up in him for eternal life. And if you receive a drink from Jesus, you don't have to come back for another. His living water becomes its own everlasting well, and you will thirst no more. And that's verse 14. Now, if we read the rest of the book or the rest of the chapter, she starts talking. Oh, yeah, yeah, no, I've heard this. Right? I know that the Messiah is coming. And then he says, well, I'm him. I'm the Messiah. And then she's like, oh, yeah, no. We know that they're coming. They talk about worshiping and all this other stuff. And she says, no, I'm coming. And he goes, I'm going to go back. He goes, yeah, I'll tell you what. Why don't you go back and tell the guy that you're living with, right? Because you've had five other dudes. You've been married to other guys. The guy you're living with now, you're not even married to. And so, yeah, I see you. Jesus ever do that to you? Jesus ever just speak into you and say, no, I see you. And he points out all those things. I remember asking God one time, I said, Father, I know that there are probably some unrepented sin in my life that I just don't realize or I'm not aware of. And I asked that you would point them out to me. Will you show that to me? And instantly, I mean, he started downloading, and I became overwhelmed and I started weeping. I said, whoa, that's a lot. And I just asked God, please forgive me for those things. Please forgive me for the, and you can imagine what she's feeling, right? She's standing in the presence of Jesus and she's starting to recognize that he's the Messiah. And here's the cool thing, man. She went back into town and told all those people who spoke bad about her, spoke behind her back, and told them who she met. You've got to come and see the one who knew everything about me. You see, listen, Jesus is the living water and we must introduce Cheyenne to him. And there are people in Cheyenne who keep coming back to the wrong well. And we need to tell them all about living water. Listen to what Jesus says in John 7. He says, on the last and most important day of the festival, Jesus stood up and cried out, if anyone is thirsty, say anyone. If anyone is thirsty, let him come to me and drink. The one who believes in me, as the scripture has said, will have streams, say streams, will have streams of living water flow from deep within him. Listen, Jesus says, the one who believes in me will have streams of living water flow from deep within them. You have a well of living water in you, and his name is Jesus.
Amen.
Turn to your neighbor and say, Jesus is our foundation. So he says, Jason, you're going to name it living water. So here we are. We're looking at the third part of the vision. And the third part of the vision is talking about the building. Now remember, church is not the building. Church is you. Right? Remember that church is a living organism, and it is not an organization. You do not want to be a part of a church organization. You want to be a part of a church organism that is moving, that is flowing, because you got streams of living water flowing within you, and you need to tell the world about Jesus, right? Come on. And you heard me say last time, when people call me and say, what's the dress code? Don't dress too pretty. Come on, man, right? It's not about what you wear. It's about who's in you. That's all that matters. Right? We're not here to judge what you wear. We just want to know where you are with Jesus. That's all that matters. So if you're wearing a shirt and a t-shirt and tennis shoes and it's December outside, come on in. We're going to have the heat on for you. Right? It does not matter. I do not care. I care about where you are in your walk. That's what's important to me. And here we are now in the third part of our vision. I call this not a normal church building, right? In order to build a church building, you have to have a foundation. Listen to Isaiah 28. Therefore, the Lord God said, look, I have laid a stone in Zion, a tested stone, a precious cornerstone, a sure foundation. The one who believes will be unshakable. Say unshakable.
Unshakable.
Turn to your neighbor and say, you're unshakable.
Unshakable.
Turn to the person on the other side and say, you're unshakable.
Unshakable.
Look at the person behind you and say,
I'm unshakable.
Unshakable. Yes, listen. Jesus is either the stone we trip over in our self-righteousness, or he's the rock we build our lives upon. Right? So Psalms 118:22 says this: the stone that the builder rejected has become the cornerstone. Listen, this psalmist here is using this building metaphor to teach an important truth. He's teaching the builders rejected a stone that God selected. And in his sovereign and in providence, he ensured that this particular stone would become the cornerstone of a figurative building of his design. And it would be the stone on which everything else would be aligned. The stone is Jesus. Listen, in living water, Jesus is our foundation and our cornerstone. We stand on him alone, and we are held by him alone. Why? Because we're unshakable. We are unshakable. The enemy has come and tried to shut these doors. Listen, don't let any man try to shut a door that God had opened up.
Yes.
Right? You do not let the enemy come and say, you have to go down this way, when the Lord says, you keep going down this way. You need to pay attention to what God is saying and not what the world is saying. Right? Turn to your neighbor and say, Jesus is our foundation.
Jesus.
So not a normal building. When we step out and build our own building, it's not going to be a normal building. Listen, I have a picture. It's a horrible picture. It's a picture of the possible land that we might be purchasing. Right? Squint if you can. And so this right here, this is on Ridge Road. And this road that you see on your right, that is Rollins. And so it's in between Pershing and Del Range. You'll see that there's a house on there, okay? This is 3 acres of land, and it's right behind the golf course out there, right? So we got golf course property, okay? And so this is the possible land, and I've taken some people there, we prayed over it, and we're seeking God to open doors. Okay, a buddy of mine owns this, and we were looking all last summer, and he is the only property owner who ever spoke the name of Jesus. And when he said this, he says, Jason, I've had people come and offer me to purchase this land. And he says, but the Lord has been telling me to sell it to a church. And they are offering him a great amount of money. And he says, so I believe that my Heavenly Father wants me to give this to you at a certain price.
Amen. 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 Praise the Lord.
So God, if that's where you want us to go, if that's where you want us to build our foundation, then I know that you open doors more.
Amen.
But here's the thing. Here's what the building will look like. Now, last 2 weeks, I've shown you what it looks like because we have been involved in it. We were doing it. We are doing it. But this is something that is the vision hasn't started yet, but I believe it's coming. So the Bible says in 1 Thessalonians 5:17, it says this: pray constantly. Okay? So in our building, we will have a 24-hour prayer center. This is going to be on the very top of the building, and it will have a 365-degree view of the city. There will always be worship music playing, whether it be live music or canned music. You're going to see prayer requests on TV screens that will be coming from all around the world, and we're going to be praying. There are going to be people who are going to be healed in this place. There are going to be people who are going to just be prayed over and have breakthroughs. I guarantee it's going to be happening. But the reason why we are up on the very top level is so that we can see our city, and we're constantly praying for our city in Jesus' name. Okay? Right? Now, here's the other thing. I don't know how this is going to work, but our God is the God of possibilities. Okay? Right? And so, in this building, we are going to have an orphanage wing. Okay? I don't even know what that looks like. What I do know is that we will have space for these children, and it won't look like a dormitory like when you went to basic training in the military. It won't look like that, right? And I'm not quite sure if it'll be like a house that'll be on there or what have you, but we are going to make sure that all children are going to be loved on, and they'll be loved on by us, right? So this will be, they'll have their own rooms, and God only knows, right? As we start building, I believe he's going to reveal more of that, right? On this property, there will be a greenway kind of walk, right? And it'll go all the way around the property. And you know when you go on the greenway, you stop at the stations and you can work out? nobody walks the Greenway here, okay? So on the Greenway, when you go out there, there are stations where you can work out and do push-ups and sit-ups and jumping jacks and all that stuff. Well, at our property, as you go walking around the Greenway, so this property that we have is 3 acres, right? So you go walking around, and at every station is a prayer station. And this is where you're going to come and you're going to pray. There will be constant worship music playing outside. Listen, there will be constant worship music playing 24/7 in the building, even when nobody's there. Right? It will be playing outside as well. Right? So when you're walking out there, you're going to hear this worship music. It's like when you walk into a certain kingdom at Disneyland, you know how they have their own theme music? You know what I'm talking about? Nobody here knows what I'm talking about. Okay? All right? Maybe when you go to a department store, the same music that's playing inside is playing on the outside. Anybody there? Maybe when you're sitting at McDonald's and there's a car that's bumping its music, you can hear it on the inside. When you come outside, you can hear it on the outside. You're with me. Okay, so there's going to be worship. I'm just trying to relate, right? So here's the thing about Disneyland. When you walk into a certain kingdom, they play different songs so that you know that you're in a certain kingdom. My thought is if they can do it, why can't we do it? Right? Why not do it? Here on the outside, there will be water features at the entrance, and they'll have streams and creek that flow from them. At the very top of the church will be a cross on the very top, and it'll be lit at all times for all to see. It'll be as tall as the peak of the Capitol, because I do believe, if I'm thinking right, there is a law or something that there can be no building taller than the Capitol in the state of Wyoming. Now, they got approval of that in Laramie because of the dormitories, but if I understand that right. So, if there are any elected officials here, tune out right now, okay? Tune out. I want to take that cross, and I want to take it an inch higher. That's all I want to do. Right? That's all I want to do. And if they say it's an inch higher, I'm going to make the measure from the bottom all the way to the top. I don't know if they'll do it, right? But that's the deal. Here's the reason why. Because I want Jesus, man, to be spread. I want it to be seen from all over the place. That's what I want it to be, right? And so we're going to be declaring Jesus. Here's the other thing. Inside this church building, we will have a walk-in freezer and fridge. It'll be like a distribution center. Now, you heard me say that we don't need to reinvent the wheel, we just gotta help the wheel move. But when I was at Kamiya House and we were receiving pallets and pallets of food and we were helping them out, Kamiya, Salvation Army, and St. Joe's were there. And I'm having a conversation. I said, hey, how can we stop all this stuff? And he says, because Kamiya was saying, hey, our freezers get so full, we're trying to send them out to other places. And I said, so what is it that you truly need? And all three of them, right? Because these are the three food distribution or food providers to our community, right? Reinvent the wheel, not reinventing the wheel, how to make it move. They said, if we had a place where we could bring all of this food into storage and have someone distribute it out to other things, that would help us tremendously. I said, you got it, we're doing it, right? That was 7 years ago, right? But here's the thing. They call us, we store it, and we start pumping it out. Here's the other thing. Other churches have food pantries as well. I know that Element has one of the biggest ones here as well. Why can't we help provide food for them too? I just want to help the wheel move. That's all I want to do, right? I just want to distribute the food out as much as I can. And here's the thing, we don't know what our city needs unless we go out into the city and find out what it needs. That's why we're a church on the street. That's what we do. But listen to this, Matthew 25, for I was hungry, you gave me something to eat. I was thirsty, and you gave me something to drink. I was a stranger, and you took me in. I was naked, and you clothed me. I was sick, and you took care of me. I was in prison, and you visited me. On this property, we will have a garden and orchard on this place, right? I know it's Wyoming. You're like, Jason, nothing grows here. We'll figure it out, okay? But here's the thing. We want our people in our community. I don't care. I don't care if you're homeless. I don't care what's going on in your life. I do not care. But I just want you to come, and I want you to pluck the fruit off the tree, and I want you to take what you need out of the garden. Everything's free. Why? Because nobody will go hungry in Cheyenne, Wyoming. No way. Because this is our backyard. This is our promised land. So we're going to take care of our folks. Oh, I hope you're writing all this down, because there's more to come, right? Now listen to this. Now, it will have, our church will have, this building will have its own gymnasium. Shut up, Jason. What are you talking about? Your own gymnasium. Yes, we will. In fact, we will have instructors, right? So what I envisioned was, is like spinning, right? Because I want to start riding bikes because I can't run anymore, right? So I was thinking about spinning instructors, right? And they're spinning out to worship music and all that stuff. But the instructor comes and can start praying over people, start laying hands on people while they're there. Like, this is a Jesus house, and we're going to do Jesus things, right? And so here we are. We're going to have them spread the gospel and talk about just laying hands on people, right? Did you know that the Bible talks about working out? It does. Check this out. Philippians 2. It says, therefore, my dear friends, just as you have always obeyed, so now, not only in the presence, but even more in my absence, work out your own salvation with fear and trembling. It says that. I found it. I couldn't believe it. God, you're good. Right? Romans 1:16 says this, right, for the instructors. For I am not ashamed of the gospel, because it is the power, right? So if you're working out, what are you going to get? The power of God for salvation to everyone who believes. First the Jew and also to the Greek, right? This is a gym where Jesus is talked about and shared constantly. Woo!
Hallelujah.
I'll join that gym. Then I started thinking about this. I started thinking about this recently, maybe about 4 or 5 years ago. I introduced you all to Sabrina, the one who helps us with the haircuts at the Christmas Eve sermon, right? She's the one who cuts all the hair in her team, and it's all for free, right? So, Sabrina, my thought is why can't this place have a salon in it?
Yes!
Why can't we do that? You know, the Bible talks about cutting hair, too. Listen to the 2 Samuel 14. says, no man in all Israel was handsome and highly praised as Absalom. From the sole of his foot to the top of his head, he didn't have a single flaw. Tree thinks about me like that. Right? When he shaved his head, there it is. When he shaved his head, he shaved it at the end of every year because his hair got so heavy for him that he had to shave it off. He would weigh the hair from his head, and it would be 5 pounds according to the royal standard. Listen, if he came to our church building and he messed up, he wouldn't have to worry about that 5 pounds. We'd be cutting his hair, right? That's where you find haircuts, okay? Listen, our building will also have this, after school ministries, right? It's another place where kids can come and parents have options to bring them in. It'll have outside its own park for children and community to play on. Listen, man, I visited the church in Sun Valley, and they were struggling to keep their doors open, and they asked me if I would come in and kind of help them out, and I said yes, and I brought one of my leaders, and we went walking around their neighborhood. They're in a community, a neighborhood, and it was the summer, and what I saw was a bunch of people on their property, and they took all the swings off the swing set, they took the rim off the hoop, and they had nowhere to go. Right? Nowhere to go. And I thought to myself, why are you doing that? And so I asked him, I said, your neighbors want to play on your property and you have nothing out there. Why is it? He says, it's a liability. It's an insurance liability. Well, you can fix that. All you need to do is put up signs. Play at your own risk. You break your arm, that's on you. Right? You can do that. It's you can do that. And they won't hold you liable. No, Jason, we will never do that. Okay. Two kids rolled in while we had the doors open, right? They had their bikes in. And the pastor's like, hey, do you guys want to come in and check us out? And you know what these kids said? These are kids on bikes. They said, no. My mom says that this is the dead church. And I looked at this pastor. He's like, are you ready to put the swings on now? He didn't, and they almost shut the door, but they brought another pastor in who really went after it, right? And so we are going to open up to our community and say, we're here. Just come as you are, whatever you want, right? And this place is going to be a place where there'll be a cafe that's open, right? Oh, churches and cafe, right? But here's the thing. I go out into the community, and I'm meeting with people out of restaurants and stuff, and I'm seeing my fellow pastor friends standing or sitting there just trying to get away from the crowd so they can do their work. Why not open up a space where they can come and just sit and not be bothered? Why? They're my brothers, right? And they are, they're in the community. We're doing the same. Just come to my place. Nobody's going to say anything. I'm not going to say, well, there's magic over here. I'm not going to say it. We won't bother you. Just come and be, right? Listen, are there teenagers in this room right now? Are y'all listening? Perk up. Check this out. This is a place where you're going to be able to call your own. All I hear from this generation is there's nothing to do in Cheyenne. I grew up in Cheyenne, so I agree. Right? So let's give you something to do. So in this building, we will have a youth center, right? Listen to this. Oh, some of you old adults, you better tune out as you younger adults tune in. Why can't we have a place on Friday nights where they can come and dance to Christian music? Right? Why don't they come and dance and worship? Oh, Ecclesiastes says, a time to weep, a time to laugh, a time to mourn, a time to dance. Right? Even David in 2 Samuel said, David was dancing with all his might before the Lord. When did it go away that we're not allowed to dance? Please don't watch me worship when I stand up right here, because I'm swaying and I'm moving. I almost went into breakdance and stuff. I want to give them a place where they can come and call their own. And if we have Friday night dances, I don't care. The question is what if and why not?
That's right.
What if it does work and why not? Why can't it work? I want to give them a place. Turn to your neighbor and say, Jesus is our foundation. But we're not done there. Oh, no, we're not done there. Here at Living Water, we want to impact our community, right? The church is to impact the community, not the other way around. So we, as a church, we have been praying in to buying a hotel. We want to buy a hotel, and we want to make that a transitional living house. Here's the thing. I don't know how to run a hotel, but I didn't know how to plant a church either. But the Lord will open it up. And we want to open up, we want to buy a hotel. And this is the thing. We want to help people who are struggling to get on their feet, get on their feet. We want to focus on single mothers and single dads who are possibly going to school or going to work. And we want to give them tools and teach them how to budget and grow their own food, maybe go through some child development classes, learn some life skills. We want to invest in some young families, right? Those who are needing to get help on their feet. Now, this is going to be a program that will last from 18 months to 2 years, right? But in that 18 months to 2 years, we are building them up to become stronger and better. And by the time they are done, they should be able to stand on their own. Why? Because Jesus is our foundation. Say, Jesus is our foundation. Oh, man, I'm so glad you asked, because, yes, we have some more things up our sleeve that we want to do, too. Right? Not only do we want to buy a hotel. Listen, buy a hotel? Who buys a hotel? What if and why not? The next thing is we want to own a business, okay? And in my mind, the business is like a restaurant. And in this business, right, these are for those who may be living in that hotel or those who are just needing a job. But here's the thing. We are going to be teaching them, so like as a restaurant, we want them to learn all positions so they can make it on their own. A hostess, a cook, a manager, a supervisor, a waiter, a waitress, whatever. We want to do that. Right? And the goal is to get them on their feet and help them be successful. Right? And then they move on and they become franchise owners or something like that. Here's the question. What if and why not? I've already done the work. And here's the thing. It cannot be under our 501c3. But we can have an arm or a branch off of it where we have a business side of it that Living Water will oversee it. And Living Water, it will be Living Waters, right? It's not going to be... I don't know. It's not going to be anything else. The name will be Living Water. Why? Because Cheyenne needs his living water. Right? And so it'll be the motel. It'll be a restaurant. And here's the thing. Why can't it spread? Why can't we go out and do more? Why can't we do more? The thing is, we can. Because all things are possible through Jesus Christ. Right? He is the one that we walk into. He's the one we're hand in hand. I cannot make this up on my own. I'm not this smart to come up with something like this. It's all about and restaurant? You see, he's sitting at my well, and I'm like, I don't know how to run a motel. I don't know how to run a restaurant. He says, I do.
There you go.
And he'll reveal them to me when we step into it. Now here's the deal. All this is going to take, it's going to take all of us. And I need you to start praying about this. Let's put this next slide up. This is our legacies, legacy slide, right? So some of you have seen this, okay? Right now, we call this the legacy campaign, building the building and doing all that stuff. You'll see that we're sitting right now at $61,000, right? Our goal is to reach $200,000 because you've got to put 20% down on the land. And obviously he wants to sell it to us for $1 million, which we looked at property that was 4 acres, three blocks south on the same road. And it was an acre more and they wanted $2.4 million. We sat with the city, we talked to them, they want an additional $250,000 to bring it up to code to the city. And just three blocks north, God said, check this out. I'm reducing it by $1.4 million. And the guy who owns the property loves me. So I'm asking, you'll see this. The legacy campaign is gonna take all of us, right? And what I want you to do is I want you to pray about how you can give. I want you to ask the God, the Lord to guide you on this, right? Because this goes above and beyond your tithing. Right? God, what is it that you want me to do? How do you want me to invest? Right? So here's the question, right? How do you fit into the vision that we've talked about this month? I want you to know that I've prayed for all of you before I even knew you. I prayed for you the morning that I was on that run and the Lord gave me the vision. I started praying for you. In fact, I pray for all of you now, and I'm still praying for those who are on their way. I'm praying that God will send us the ones that nobody wants and the ones who want to dig in the trenches and get after it with us, right? So here's the question. Have you signed up to volunteer in the house yet? We have places already where you can help us help volunteer here at Living Water. And it's at the Welcome Center. Our children, our youth, our greeters, our cafe, our Welcome Center, you name it, we need your help. It's blank out there. If you're sitting here and you're thinking, hey, I want to get involved, then get involved. Maybe this is your second time here and you know that this is home, get involved. There's no classes that you need to go through. We just want you to get involved, right? Because we believe in partnership, not membership. We believe in partnership. Partnership means investment. Membership means go to the Sam's Club, get a car, right? So here's the thing. We want you to get involved, right? If this is home, let's get involved in the home. Right? We need your help. Trudy and I cannot do this by ourselves. We love our volunteers. We love you, but we need your help. I don't know if you know this, but in the last month, so in August, so here we are coming in, so 2 months, our children's ministry has doubled in 2 months. Our youth ministry has tripled in 2 months. Come on, church. You hear what I'm saying? And we need you. We need you parents. Folks to pull them under your wing and let's teach this generation, right? We're worried about that generation. Let's love on that generation, right? So if that's you and you're praying about it, hey, sign up. Listen, we're the church on the street, right? So I've asked the Lord to give me a waiting list of volunteers. That's the dream of a pastor. Lord, if I could just have a waiting list of volunteers, we get that here. I love that. When we say, hey, this is what we need to do in the community, some of you sprint. I was like, I only need 18. I'm like, oh man, I got 19, right? But it's cool. I love that, right? No fighting, though. No fighting. No fighting. Right? And this is the thing. Listen, all this happens not because of me. Right? All this happens because of the Lord through you. That's why. And here's the next question. Are you ready to build that not normal church? Are you ready for it? Because it's going to take all of us together to do this. It's going to take all of us. So here's the question. What if and why not? Right? The Lord is doing a new thing. Can't you see it? because I believe that Jesus is building our unshakable foundation. I'm just in love with God. I love what the Lord is doing. I love what the Lord is doing in Living Water, and I love what the Lord is doing in you. You're important. You're valuable. You have been designed and created fearfully and wonderfully. The Lord sees you and knows where you are. Some of you may be thinking, no, he doesn't. No, he does, right? Because he's sitting at your well. My question is, are you ready to surrender? Is the foundation you're on a little shakable? Or do you want to get on some unshakable ground? Listen, I'm going to tell you, it's not going to be a smooth ride. It's just not. You're going to deal with some trials and tribulations. You're going to probably go through some health scares. But I will tell you this, it is so much easier when you have Jesus on your side. So much easier. I had a health scare this week. Pretty scary. I'm sitting in the emergency room. Just to let you guys know, they do not make beds long enough for dudes like us, right? And all I kept thinking is, as they're doing their number on me, I'm just laying there. And all I kept thinking in my head was this song. And all I kept singing was, oh, how I love Jesus. Oh, how I love Jesus. Oh, how I love Jesus, because he first loved me. And I'm just singing that in my head, right? Just singing it in my head. I ignore everything else, because I know he's sitting in my well. And that was Wednesday. And I just gotta tell you, today I feel great. Like, I feel great. Still a little sweaty, but it's all good. And I just want you to know, man, that he loves me so much that all I can think about on that short bed was how much he loves me and how much my legs are hanging off the bottom of this thing, right? You know what they have great at the hospital is those warm heated blankets. Those are amazing. Like, hallelujahs for that. My wife's like, can I get one? Yeah, get her two. These two. Whew. I don't even know why I shared that with you. But I want to say this, right? If you've never asked Jesus to be the Lord and Savior of your life, never asked him. I guess my question to you is why not? Why not now? Why not give your life to Christ right now today? The Bible tells us that God loved us so much that he gave his one and only Son, that whoever believes in him will not perish but have everlasting life. Oh, how I love Jesus. Jesus says that I am the way, the truth, and the life. And no one comes to the Father except for me. Oh, how I love Jesus. He says that I didn't come to condemn the world, but I come to save the world. Oh, how I love Jesus, because he first loved you. When he was on that cross, he was thinking about you. He had your name on his heart. Even though you weren't around, he was thinking about you. I'm wondering if you're ready to surrender your life to him. I'm wondering if you're ready to take that step. Maybe some of you have given your life to Christ, but you just got off track somewhere along the line. You know, and I got to get back on track. It's time to get back on track, right? I call this the comeback, right? You're coming back to Jesus. Here's the cool thing. As you're running back to him, he's running to you. Come on, let's go. And so, with every head bowed and every eye closed, I just want to pray for you. For those of you who say, I need Jesus in my life. If that's you, just no one's looking. Just slip up your hand. No one's paying attention. I just want to pray for you. I know that I need Jesus in my life. I need him as my Lord and Savior. I've been holding back. I've been waiting too long. And if that's you, just slip up your hand. Or maybe you're saying, I just need to rededicate my life. I need to get back after it. If that's you, just slip up your hand. I just want to pray with you. I want to walk with you. Yeah, so Father, I praise you and thank you, God, for what you're doing. I thank you that you're our foundation, our unshakable foundation. I thank you, God, for how you're moving in our lives. I thank you, God, how you are encouraging us. I thank you, God, for how you're moving in us. Father, I pray you give us more visions and dreams. Father, I pray, God, that there would be breakthrough happening in this place right now, God. Those things that we need to step out of and step into. Father, I pray, God, that you would touch those who are battling depression, God, or anxiety. Father, I pray, God, that you bring healing to those relationships that need to be healed, Father. I pray, God, that you would remove those bad thoughts that are not of you, but God, of the thoughts that are of you. God, I pray that we'd walk in to the things that you want us to walk into, God, knowing our true identity, walking on your unshakable foundation. God, that's who we are. That's what we believe in. And so, Father, I thank you, God, for what you're doing here at Living Water, and Father, what you're doing for the folks here. And God, and I ask you to do more. Do it more. Show off more. Thank you, Father. We praise you and thank you. Hallelujah. We love you so much. It's in Jesus' name we pray. Amen. Well, listen, today is Baptism Sunday. We're not done yet, right? So if you looked at your watch, too bad, right? So this is Baptism Sunday. We are excited. We actually have 4 people who are getting baptized today. Believer and follower of Jesus Christ, and he's here today in front of you to be baptized because it is a public profession of faith. Okay. And so, Tom, what is your public profession of faith?
Lord, or Jesus is my Lord and Savior.
Hallelujah. Right. Well, you know, perfect. Tom, we now baptize you in the name of the Father and the Son and the Holy Spirit. Yeah!
Oh yeah, it's really
cool. All right, Patrick, my man. Come on in. Tom says it's warm.
Oh yeah,
it's warm. Nice, nice. It's warm.
It's good up to see you.
All right, so this is a good friend of mine, Patrick, and he is also a believer and follower of Jesus Christ. And so he's in front of all of you. And so, Patrick, what is your public profession of faith?
Jesus Christ is my Lord and Savior.
Right there. Patrick, we now baptize you in the name of the Father, and the Son, and the Holy Spirit. Yeah! All right. All right, so now I'm going to bring in Mike.
It's okay.
Did you in the hot tub? Yeah, come sit.
You got this.
Yeah, you know how I felt this week. All right, so this is another good friend of mine. This is Mike. And so Mike is a believer and follower of Jesus, and he is here to be baptized in front of you all today. And so, Mike, what is your public profession of faith?
Jesus is my Lord.
All right. Amen. You know, bring your hand up here. Mike, we now baptize you in the name of the Father, the Son, and Holy Spirit. Yeah! 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 All right. Okay, you ready? So this is Mike's daughter. This is Audrey, right? Audrey? Okay. And so we're gonna help you in, okay?
I love it so much.
Yeah. Happy go ahead and sit down. We'll make it quick, okay? Audrey is also one who's given her life to Jesus. And so she's here to be baptized in front of you all. And so, Audrey, what is your public profession of faith?
Jesus.
Yes.
Yes. Grab your hand right here by where your dad's hand is. Grab your wrist, okay? All right, Audrey, we now baptize you in the name of the Father, and the Son, and the Holy Spirit. Woo! Yeah! Yeah! Okay, so there was one more who was thinking about stepping in. Dad's hand.
Nice and warm.
Oh, it's super warm.
Okay, turn around this way. Go ahead and have a seat, okay? So this is Addie, and Addie is also a believer and follower of Jesus Christ. And so, Addie, what is your public profession of faith? God. Yes, indeed. Grab your notes.
Grab your notes.
Yep. You good? All right, Addie, we now baptize you in the name of the Father, and the Son, and the Holy Spirit.
This is Junior. Job, Junior. He's like, well, that took my breath away.
So, Junior, I'm going to ask you what your public profession of faith is. And all I want you to say is Jesus is Lord, okay?
Say Jesus is Lord, okay?
You ready?
Too cold?
Yeah. We'll make it quick.
We'll go fast.
We'll do it quick. You ready?
Yeah.
Okay, let's go.
Just say Jesus is Lord.
Okay,
you got it.
Sit down on your rear end.
Too cold? Okay. We'll splash you.
How about this? Let's just pour water over your head. Is that okay?
Yeah.
Is that okay?
Let's do it fast.
Okay. Who's got a cup?
Anyone got a cup?
All right, Junior, we now
just
baptize
say,
you.
Lord.
We now Ready? Baptize you in the name of the Father, and
nope.
the Son,
you say just
and
fine.
The Holy Spirit. Ready?
Woo!
Father, I pray, God, that you give us an amazing week, that we'd walk with you and you would meet us at the well where we need you to meet us. And so, Father, we just ask, God, that you continue to shine and guide Tom and Patrick, God, and Mike and Audrey and Addie and Junior, Father. We just lift them up to you, God. We thank you, Father, for what you're doing in our lives. And we ask, God, that you do more. We just pray all this in Jesus' name. Amen.
Amen.
God bless you.